I'll talk about the title in a little while, so I'll not start with the title really, I'll start with something else. So this is just to tell you that a meeting like this in condensed matter physics, which has, I was just talking to Indranidhi, that it has become very common nowadays, and they are always sort of likely to succeed, because in condensed matter physics it is generally quite easy to find a problem. And why is it easy? It is easy because if you are going to explore the properties of a new material, which is not always so easy to get, you can at least take the new material and do some substitution or increase the complexity, and then you can keep on churning out a new thesis. Like when I talk of complexity, what I mean is that if you take, for example, simple elements like aluminium or niobium, the TC is usually below 10K. If you want TC between 10 and 25K,
It is too low. Okay.
Is it better now? Okay. So if you want the TC in a slightly higher range, you have to go to 2 elements, then 3 elements, 4 elements, 5 elements, like that. And the TC sort of goes up monotonically the more complex the system is. Now, the other way to do research in solid state physics is slightly better. You can start looking at the news at the same system with new techniques, or you can change the temperature or change the pressure and things like that. Today I'm going to talk about this is the subject that I'm going to work on. I do work on is what can you look at, what new information can you get by decreasing the dimensionality or decreasing the size. And then just like temperature and pressure, can you consider size as a kind of control parameter or a kind of variable of state, like a thermodynamic variable, but of course it is not. It is like a reparameterized thermodynamic variable, and I'll show you how this can be done. Why is it going off? Okay. So now this is the outline of the talk, and I'll finish this talk with the last half of my talk will be on finite size effects on superconductivity. This is the kind of challenge I always have with DD, that I have to show something new to him, because we almost always give talks at the same conference and almost often at the same session. So this is something that we are talking about. But to just give you the introduction to what I'm going to talk about, look at a very simple property like melting point. Now, a melting point has an obvious pressure dependence. As you increase the pressure, the melting point goes up by about maybe 20% or so. But if you take particle size to be the variable, then the melting point can be changed by almost a factor of 2 or factor of 3 by decreasing the particle size. And this happens, of course, the reason is quite simple. It happens because you have a larger amount of surface, and the surface atoms are easy to get rid of from the solid, so you need less energy for the surface atoms to get evaporated. Now, I'll take some random examples like this. For example, you take the self-diffusion in metals. You take bulk crystalline copper. In bulk metals, of course, the self-diffusion coefficient is extremely low, because if you take copper atoms moving inside a copper matrix at room temperature, the motion is very, very small. So the coefficient is very low, like 10 to the power minus 40 or so. You can increase it by temperature by about 10 to the power 11 times, but by changing particle size, you can do the same thing to the tune of about 10 to the power 20 times, much, much larger. And I think this is the largest change you can see in any property as a function of any other variable. So you have really very large changes in this kind of thing. And this happens because now the diffusion can take place through the grain boundaries, which is like a short circuit path, and that allows much faster movement. Now, to this audience, I don't have to introduce quantum size effects, but just to remind you about the so-called Kubo gap. As you know, when you go to small particles, the energy levels become discrete, and this discreteness is measured by the Kubo gap. So at any particular temperature, if you look at the average inter-level spacing, then this is given something like this. It's an inverse function of the volume of the particle, and this is how it is actually given. Now, the Kubo gap, of course, if the Kubo gap is of the order of between 5 and 10 millielectron volt for most elements, but KT is about 25 MeV at room temperature, so you have to go to something like between 1 to 10K to look at really, really strong effects of the Kubo gap. So my rest of the talk is going to have to do with something like Kubo gap. So that's why I wanted to talk a little bit about that. Now the Kubo gap can lead to many other things. For example, if you look at the metal insulator transition, then the metal insulator transition is something, it's a property that has been studied very frequently, and it can be changed by temperature, pressure, magnetic field, by doping and all that, and also by particle size. So it was seen quite some time back that, for example, a metal like silver can become completely insulating if you actually go to a size in which the Kubo gap is larger than the thermal energies. And the same thing can be shown much more dramatically. We have a paper from 2006 where we took a superconductor and we looked at the entire gamut of transitions from a superconductor, metallic superconductor to a non-metal, to an insulator, and to a complete insulator at about 5 nanometers. So it's a superconductor, non-metal, normal existing insulator. Now, again, continuing my series of random examples, if you look at structural phase transitions, for example, in barium titanate take place at a series of temperatures, and this is the highest one is actually the ferroelectric transition, and these are all depending on the structural transition. Other important structural transitions are, for example, BCC to HCP in iron, similar transitions in cobalt and all that. These can all be affected by temperature, pressure, magnetic field and all that. What about particle size? So again, just to give one example, the example of something like barium titanate, this is lead titanate. The tetragonal to cubic transition that takes place at about 760K is a very crucial transition because this is a ferroelectric transition. And this depends on this structural distortion. The C by A distortion actually makes it ferroelectric. And we showed that the same transition can take place now at room temperature by just decreasing the particle size. So the C by A ratio, which is something like the order parameter for the material, can also be decreased just by sitting at room temperature and changing the particle size. You can go from completely ferroelectric to a paraelectric state by just decreasing the particle size. And we have shown how and why this occurs. But today I'm not going to discuss that. Just to show that this shows the destruction of ferroelectricity as you go down in particle size. So now this happens, this kind of changes in the structural phase transition happen in many different kinds of materials. Much of it has been studied by us over many years. And in all of them, you'll find, in most of them, you'll find that there is an increase in the lattice parameter or the unit cell volume as you go from the large particle state to the small particle state. So for example, the cubic phase here has a larger unit cell volume than the rhomboidal phase here. And also, you generally tend to go to more and more symmetric structures as you go down in particle size. And we had an early model to show why there is a lattice expansion as you go down in particle size in oxides. And that is because if you look at the atoms which lie on the surface, then these actually are dangling bonds. And these dangling bonds on the surface will act like surface dipoles, which will repel each other and give you a net isotropic expansion of the lattice. Now, this does not happen in metallic nanoparticles, because in metallic nanoparticles, you don't have a sort of dangling bond on the surface. But in a metal, the predominant interaction is actually something like a surface tension. And the surface tension will tend to contract the metallic particle. So as you go down in particle size, you actually tend to decrease the lattice parameter to smaller and smaller values. And this was shown also quite some time back by various people. And this extent of the contraction can be explained quite nicely by a surface, very simple surface energy kind of argument. Now, if you just plot all the data that we have got, that people have got for different kinds of metals, so these are the standard metals like aluminium, copper, niobium, tantalum, palladium, and all that. Now, most of them show a decrease, as I said, because of surface energy, but recently, we have been finding a few cases where there is an expansion in the unit cell volume as you go down in particle size, which is not expected because then it is not a surface energy kind of effect. And this happens, as we just found out, this happens almost always in BCC metals. So FCC metals contract, BCC metals expand as you go down in particle size. And very interestingly, this effect has been actually explained by by us in collaboration with Tanushree Shahadas Gupta, and we have got a model to show why only BCC metals should actually show an expansion and FCC metals should show a contraction. Maybe my next talk will be on that. So now this is the sort of the main sort of working part of my talk. And can you tell me how much time I have so that I can?
So you have 20 minutes.
Very good. So now I will go a little slowly because this is the sort of main heart of the talk. And the main thing that we are going to discuss now is that what happens, or I can put the question like this: can superconductivity persist in arbitrarily small particles? Now, almost any property, magnetism, any property that you think of, gets quite sort of drastically modified as you go down to small particles, and superconductivity is no exception. But in this case, there is a very definite limit, which has been set by somebody, which shows where a superconducting particle should actually become non-superconducting, or the superconducting ground state becomes destabilized as a function of particle size, and that is what I am going to tell you. So this is the correlation between size and the transition temperature, and a review of this finite size effects has recently been published by us some time back. So that gives you the state of the art till that time. But it does not tell you what I'm going to tell you now. So now let me explain to you what is the ground state of a zero dimensional superconductor. Now, if you're looking at particle size effects in systems which have some kind of long range order, which is always very interesting because they have some correlation length like magnetism or like ferroelectricity, then you can actually compare this particle size to that correlation length and expect to see changes as you go down below that particular size. Now, superconductivity is special because superconductivity has a number of correlation lengths, not just one. So if you look at the obvious correlation lengths, you have the coherence length and you have the magnetic field penetration length. So which length scale is more relevant to size effects? So let us look at some data. So first, I will not explain to you, but I'm sure most of you know what the coherence length is. It is roughly the size of the Cooper pair, the BCS Cooper pair. And the penetration depth is very, very simple. It is just the decay of the external magnetic field within the superconductor. And the exponent of the decay shows you where the penetration depth is. So if you look at these length scales for typical superconductors like aluminum to niobium, then these have TCs in the range of 1 to 9. I'm looking at basically pure metals because I want to study things which are otherwise well understood. I don't want to go into high TC superconductors where the mechanism itself is debatable. But here, the mechanism is most of them are typical BCS superconductors, which are either weak coupling or intermediate coupling or even strong coupling. And this is the xi0, the coherence length, and this is the penetration depth lambda l. Xi0 shows a large variation, but penetration depth does not usually vary too much. So let us see what happens when we go down in particle size below this limit. And this is data from published literature. So if you look at indium, for example, the xi0 is here, the lambda l is here, but indium remains superconducting till much lower than that. Similar is the case with tin, with niobium, with lead. These are the values of the typical coherence length and the penetration depth with arrows. And you can go much below those sizes and still retain superconductivity. So these sort of fundamental length scales like the coherence length or the penetration depth have nothing to do with particle size effects, which is quite interesting. And you can also see that the variation of TC in some cases is non-monotonic, but in most cases it is actually monotonic. So I'll go into that also in a little bit. So we need a third length scale. So as I said, these two length scales are useless, so we need a third length scale. The third length scale is slightly more complicated, but this is the length scale that is set by quantum confinement, which you would expect to be the most dominant effect here. So again, let me remind you that the Kubo gap is given by the delta equation here. So the small delta I'm denoting as Kubo gap, and the capital delta I'm denoting as the superconducting energy gap. The superconducting energy gap, of course, is the energy gap that opens up at the Fermi level as you go from higher temperatures to lower temperatures. And this gap opens because these electrons now get condensed and form Cooper pairs. So they are not sort of available within the band picture as it is. So the superconducting gap, the BCS gap, is given by something like 1.77 into KBTC. So if TC is higher, the gap is also higher. So now where does the length scale come from? So now it is not difficult to show that. So if you look at a normal metal, then you have a continuous, normal bulk metal has a continuous band structure. A bulk superconductor has, as I said, a small gap opening up near the Fermi level. But now if you go to small particles, then the small particles have a discrete energy band structure. And there is also the energy band, the energy gap, which is here. Now this discreteness is because of the Kubo gap. And now as you go smaller and smaller in sizes, this discreteness will also increase. The inter-level spacing will increase. And at a certain certain particle size, this inter-level spacing will become larger than the superconducting energy gap. So what is going to happen then? That means that you have no longer enough electrons near the Fermi level to form the Cooper pairs. And the Cooper pairs are at the heart of superconductivity. If you cannot form, if you don't have the electrons to form the Cooper pairs, the superconducting state becomes destabilized as it is. So this is the situation where you should have a destruction of superconductivity. And this was predicted by Anderson. It is called variously the Anderson criterion or the Anderson limit and things like that. So the Anderson criterion also gives you a very simple back of the envelope calculation for this thing. So if you take DC to be the critical size at which the superconductivity is likely to get destabilized, you can calculate it from the band gap by just using an equation like this. And this is the critical size for all these metals that I talked about. It is it doesn't vary too much. It is between, say, 4 nanometers and maybe 10 nanometers or so. So let us see now if this works. So now the rest of it is mostly our own work. So this was done quite some time back. This was in 2005, where we looked at the variation of TC as a function of particle size in not single nanoparticles, but in a sort of loosely compacted array of nanoparticles, which actually behaves like a weakly coupled Josephson junction array, which has a characteristic temperature, and that temperature is close to the temperature of the individual nanoparticles. We will assume that to be equal. We'll assume that the JJ coupled array has the same temperature as the individual nanoparticles. And you can see that the TC that we measured is extremely robust because the value is exactly the same as if you measure it from magnetization or from transport. The two points exactly overlap each other. And the other thing is that the Anderson criterion, the Anderson limit for this material is 6 nanometers. It is exactly at 6 nanometers where actually the TC goes to zero and it becomes non-superconducting. So the Anderson limit, let us look at some more cases for like for example, lead, which is another classical superconductor. In lead, the Anderson limit is it has not come to lead yet. It is the same. Okay. So in lead, the criterion gives you 4 nanometers. It remains superconducting till about that, and drastically falls to zero at 4 nanometers. So this back of the envelope calculation that's suggested by Anderson is extremely robust, and for most materials it is valid to almost plus minus 1K or plus minus half K. It is such a beautiful sort of application of the quantum size effects theory. So now the rest of my talk is now to look at what are the limits of the Anderson limit. Is it really so robust as you think it is? And I think this is a reasonably fundamental sort of argument, because now we are questioning the smallest length scale at which you can remain superconducting. So are there exceptions to the Anderson criterion? Aluminium appeared to be an exception because aluminium, the TC goes up, and earlier data showed that the TC does not appear to come down. But later people have more or less agreed that the TC comes down and it becomes actually non-superconducting at some finite temperature. And in some amorphous metals like amorphous tantalum, it looked like even though it is amorphous, it remains superconducting till quite low temperature. So that seems to be another sort of interesting effect. So now let us look at tantalum itself. So tantalum, most of the previous measurements on tantalum superconductivity did not agree with each other because there was always problems with contamination from amorphous backgrounds, and because there are two phases of tantalum and people could not make single phase nanoparticles of this. We spent about 6 months trying to sort of optimize the process, and then we got a rather good hold on this sputtering process to actually deposit nanocrystalline films of pure BCC tantalum on sputter deposited oxide coated silicon, and we could make particle sizes down to 2.4 nanometers from 60 nanometers. You might question why I'm writing 2.4. I'll show you that the error bars are really quite small here. And these are the extra diffraction diffractograms of the 111 line of the BCC tantalum as you go down in particle size. And you can see that the width increases and there is a shift of the line. The width increases because of the particle size becoming smaller. The shift in the line shows that there is a large lattice change. The lattice change, as I said before, is an expansion because tantalum is a BCC. So that shows an expansion, and there is about a 4% expansion of the lattice constant as you go down from bulk to the smallest size, which is in this case 2.4 nanometers. So that is part of the thing, and it shows how even the smallest size gives you a reasonably nice extra diffraction pattern. Just to give you some examples of the characterization, because nowadays without showing all this, it is impossible to get any publication out of this. So this is a transmission electron diffraction, which shows that the material is far from amorphous. It is completely crystalline. And this is a typical 6.8 nanometer nanoparticle, which you can see under a scanning tunneling electron microscope. And you can see that this is the nanoparticle, which is the extra diffraction line width is something. It gives you about 6.8 nanometer. The TM gives you almost the same. This is not, however, embedded in an amorphous medium, because this is actually done by STEM, so that shows you only those nanoparticles which are aligned in a certain directions. So nanoparticles around this will be aligned in different directions, that's why you can't see it. Doesn't mean that they're amorphous. So this is the sort of structural data on that. So I talked about 2.4 as the smallest size. Now these are very difficult samples to do because they're nanocrystalline ensembles. And you can see that for the 2.4 nanometer samples, this high resolution image gives you these nanoparticles. This is a 2 nanometer length scale, and this gives these nanoparticles. We have made a histogram from about 100 nanoparticles altogether collected, and we can show that the extra diffraction size, which was 2.4 nanometer, tallies exactly almost with the TEM size, which is 2.14 nanometer plus minus 0.28 nanometer. So the decimal place has a meaning in this case. So now we are looking at the TC, how the TC behaves. But before that, let me tell you that the expectation here would be that there is an expansion in the lattice. So there is a kind of negative pressure effect as you go down in size. What do you expect from pressure effects in this case? So for example, in tantalum, there is a data for high pressure measurements. And that shows that as you increase the pressure, the TC actually goes down. We are talking of negative pressures, which is an extrapolation like this, in which case the TC should actually increase. So let us see if that anything like that happens. So these are our measurements. Today I will not be talking about the upper critical field. The upper critical field also is very, very important and very, very interesting. I'll be talking about only the change in TC and related properties. So in nanocrystalline tantalum, in bulk tantalum, the coherence length is 92 nanometers. The Anderson size is about 4 nanometers. Now, what you can see here immediately is that as you go down in the particle size, the TC goes down as normally expected. Then it goes up. There is non-monotonic variation. It goes up and then again goes down. The HC I will not talk about. And this is the residual resistivity ratio. The observations from this are that there is a non-monotonic size dependence, which is unusual but not unprecedented. I showed you some other things, which shows that there are some competing interactions. There are many interactions which can change TC, like the quantum size effects, the surface effects. They are sort of acting in different directions. And the superconductivity also persists well below the Anderson critical limit. The Anderson limit is, as I said, 4 nanometers. We have gone down to 2.4 nanometers here, and the TC seems to be saturating there. It is not even dropping to below zero there, or not showing it tendency to drop. And let me recall you that in amorphous tantalum, what people have published earlier, they also show that even in amorphous tantalum there is a TC, and that doesn't seem to disappear with disorder or with size. So now we did a lot of calculations on this material with Umesh Waghmare, and these calculations are really very sort of revealing in many different ways. So let me show you some of the results from there. So the calculations were like this. Since it is not easy to take 2 nanometer or 3 nanometer or 4 nanometer nanoparticles and actually model them, it becomes very computer intensive, resource intensive. What he did was that he took bulk tantalum and he froze the lattice constants at those values which correspond to the nanoparticle tantalum. So for example, when you're making calculations for 4-nanometer particles, you take the 4-nanometer nanoparticle, see what lattice constant it has, and freeze the bulk lattice constant at that value to look at the effect of lattice constant on the electronic density of states, or on the phonon density of states, or on the TC and things like that. So this is a kind of a poor man's way of doing this kind of thing. So if you look at the, for example, if you look at the electronic dots here, then you can see that near the Fermi level, there is actually an increase in the dots in the nanoparticles. If you see that this is blown up here rather more, so this is the blown up part of the dots. And even though the entire density of states cannot show an increase in nanoparticles, near the Fermi level there is an increase. And if you actually look at the number of levels per mole as a function of lattice constant, and the particle size is also given here, there's a 20% increase in the number of levels near the Fermi level from bulk to 2.3 nanometers or so. This has a role to play. And then again, I'm not showing you too much of the detailed theory because there is not too much time here. So he also did very detailed phonon band structure calculations using DFPT. So this is density functional perturbation theory. And then he calculated TC using the Macmillan equation, which is a sort of expanded equation for TC. And he got for the bulk case, he got exactly 4.5K, which shows that the calculations are quite robust. They're actually following this thing. And the interesting thing in this is that as you go down in particle size, which is represented here by the lattice expansion, there is a very sharp softening of one of the modes at the endpoint, one of the phonon modes at the endpoint. So now you expect that as you go down in particle size, you have a bulk softening, bulk phonon softening, because you have an expansion. The expansion shows that the atoms are actually increasing, the inter atomic distance is actually increasing. So you expect to have a bulk phonon softening. His theory shows exactly which phonon is actually softening. So that is a very interesting aspect of this. And this is the Elias-Schwarz function, which actually comes in the superconducting TC equation in Macmillan. There also the peaks in the Elias-Schwarz function show a softening, which is actually relevant for the changes in the superconductivity. So now let me sort of summarize the changes in TC that we see and how we explain this. So these are actually, as of now, they look like a hand-waving explanation. But in our paper, we have given a completely quantitative explanation of how each of these things behave at different regions. So we can divide the total particle size regime in three regions here, region 1, 2, and 3. In region 1, the things are very simple. The TC decreases with particle size. And this is what exactly happens in niobium, in lead, and everything. And that is a simple effect of quantum size effects. So the quantum size effects is pushing TC down. But then in the region 2, there is this non-monotonic behavior. Let me also point out that there are actually two points here. So these two points have exactly the same particle size, but we repeated this experiment just to show that this peak is really genuine. So we have two points going up and another point here, which is actually two points. And here, this increase in the TC here in this intermediate region, we have shown is because of the bulk phonon softening, which I talked about, which decreases the average phonon frequencies and increases the electron phonon coupling constant, thereby increasing the TC also. So that TC increase is actually reflected here. So this is now countermanding the quantum size effects. Quantum size effect is trying to kill the TC. The bulk phonon softening is actually trying to increase the TC. Then it actually goes down, the TC goes down, because if you recall the change in the lattice constant, the lattice constant change also flattens out at low particle sizes. So now the quantum size effects can take over once more, and the TC actually comes down in this region. And now we are getting TCs down to about half the value of the D-critical, the prediction of Anderson. So now TC, the quantum size effect predominates here, but what happens to the Anderson criterion? Is the Anderson criterion really violated? So let us look at that a little more in detail. So this is my last sort of technical slide. So now we have to understand the implication of Anderson limit. the prediction of Anderson limit is not holding. It is not correct. But the philosophy of Anderson limit cannot be wrong, because you cannot really have superconductivity when there are no electrons to form the Cooper pairs. So even now, the superconductivity will still be destroyed when the Cooper gap is larger than the supergravitic energy gap. But now we have to look at exactly what happens to these cases. So normally, in these calculations, we assume that the superconducting energy gap remains constant as a function of particle size. This is the normal expectation. And the Cooper gap actually goes up like this. It has a 1 over d cubed variation. So it goes up. And this is the point at which Anderson predicts destabilization of superconductivity, DC0. Now, what we have shown here is that, first of all, the superconducting energy gap is not going to stay constant. It is going to rise because of lattice expansion in this case. So this rise will depend on how much lattice expansion there is. These are the rising parts of the superconducting energy gap. The Cooper gap, however, will now rise less slowly. It will rise less slowly than a 1 over d cubed variation, because we have shown from the electronic density of states calculation that the E dos actually increases near the Fermi level. So now it'll be at rather smaller sizes where the Cooper gap actually rises, because you're now pumping in more electrons near the Fermi level because of the rise of the density of states. So the Cooper gap will rise less slowly, and this intersection point will keep on shifting. In principle, it is possible for the intersection point to shift even below zero. That means the particle will never become superconductive, lose superconductivity with particle size. So it is now, we show now that it is possible for this to happen. Maybe in tandem that happens. And there are two things that I would like to say here. One is that the amorphous tantalum results that people had published earlier show exactly the same kind of lattice extra diffraction pattern with one broad peak. And that actually we have shown from careful TEM studies that actually has nanoparticles in it. It is not amorphous. So what people earlier thought was amorphous tantalum are really very small particle tantalum, and that's why we have shown that this amorphous tantalum now you can replace by nanocrystalline tantalum, and we have shown that is the thing that is now showing superconductivity. And what is it only something that happens in tantalum? What is the general application for this? The general application is that if it is possible for you to tune the interatomic spacing or the lattice parameter, you can play around with the TC. That means that if you make an epitaxial film on a slightly larger structure with a larger unit cell volume, then it is possible, if you can do it exactly the right way, you need only 2 or 3% or 4% increase in the lattice parameter. If you can do it correctly, you might be able to go to smaller and smaller sizes, which is very important, because once you are now looking at quantum circuits and all that, you need superconducting elements. We have shown a way by which you can countermand the Anderson effect and go to smaller and smaller sizes by changing the lattice parameter. So thank you for your attention, and I will finish by thanking my
It's a very interesting talk. So.